When we look at God, the creator of the heavens and the earth and everything in them, and then we look upon humanity and we see the world the way it is, so much evil, so much sorrow, so much pain, so much rebellion. There's just this brokenness that we see around us, and God gave us a choice, either to live in harmony with Him and obedience to Him as our great Heavenly Father, or to go our own way and to live for ourselves. And even though the very first human beings, Adam and Eve, understood that disobeying God and eating from the tree in the middle of the Garden of Eden would bring death to them and their children, sadly, they chose to reject the author of life and with rebel hearts sought to establish themselves to be their own rulers of their own destinies and to try and be their own God apart from the Lord, where they could choose to do things their own way and follow their own rules. And mankind was broken back then and continues to be broken today by rebellion. They were expelled from the garden of God, and the sentence of death came upon all as a result of their decision. And since that day, we've suffered the consequences of humanity's rebellion. And this is the message of Christmas, that God, to satisfy His justice, He needed to punish sin. The penalty of sin is death. The Bible tells us that in order to satisfy justice, God ordered that the death of an innocent life needed to die in place of the sinner. And the problem was that all the people from the time of Adam until the present day are sinners. So there was nobody clean enough or worthy enough to pay the price of this exchange. So God established, and we see this in the Old Testament, a system of animal sacrifices where innocent animals like lambs were sacrificed to provide a temporary covering for people's sin. But the life of an innocent animal could not permanently pay the price for the sins of humanity. The book of Hebrews in chapter 10, verses 3 and 4 makes it very clear. But those sacrifices are an annual reminder of sins. It is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. But the Christmas story and the beauty of Christmas is that Christ, in His great wisdom, our Creator, He did not abandon us, and He had a plan to redeem that which was lost. The Bible tells us in Amos chapter 3, verse 7, "Surely the sovereign Lord does nothing without revealing His plan to His servants, the prophets." And we've heard the story. If we've been in church our whole lives, we even heard the similar story last night, how approximately 2,700 years ago, there was a prophet named Isaiah. And God called Isaiah to prophesy to the world concerning His future plans for humanity. And He said in Isaiah 7:14, "Therefore the Lord Himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel." And Emmanuel, God with us, physically needed to be perfect. And He was to be a perfect sacrifice for humanity. This sacrifice would have to be fully God, because there's nobody that's perfect, for all our sinners. And before the righteous wrath of God could be satisfied, there had to be a sacrifice without blemish. So the Savior to be sent into the world needed to be without sin. And this is why God decided out of love for us that he would offer himself as that sacrifice because he alone is righteous. He alone is worthy. He alone is sinless. So Jesus, the Savior, to be born, would be called the Son of God, God in the flesh. The Son of God would come to the world to be a sacrifice for his people. But the Savior also needed to be a man, because to pay the price and to be the exchange for the sinner, he had to be a man as well as being God. So he was born of a virgin. Isaiah 9, 6 and 7 reads, "For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." See, Jesus needed to be the Son of God, but he also needed to be the Son of Man in order to be the perfect atoning sacrifice. And when I say atoning, you see, sin broke humanity's relationship with God. People's relationship with God is broken by sin. And God needed to deal with the sin issue. So he poured his wrath out upon his Son so that we could be set free from our guilt and our sins. See, sometimes I don't think we honestly spend enough time thinking about how much God suffered for us. God's righteous wrath against sin, he's holy. And it had to be poured out. And he who knew no sin became sin for us, so that we might become the righteousness of God. This is the meaning of Christmas. This is why Jesus needed to be born of a virgin. Kids, you maybe wonder, well, why did Jesus need to be born of a virgin? Jesus needed to be born of someone other than Adam's children. Jesus had to be broken from the chain of sin that's passed down from father to son and so on, because God held Adam responsible for the sin that came into the world, and everyone passed that inherited this sin nature from Adam. So the sacrifice could not have sin inside of him. He couldn't have a sin nature. And that's the importance of the virgin birth, is because the Father needed to be the author of what was born in Mary. And that is Jesus, God the Son, the second person in the Trinity. The Trinity is the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, all God, but each is a different person. God the Father sent his Son Jesus into the world. And Jesus, fully God, would carry all authority on his shoulders. He would be both child and king. He'd be called Mighty God. He'd be called Everlasting Father. The sinless child would be the incarnation of the eternal, everlasting God. And we see in the Bible that Jesus was in fact our Creator. The living Word of God, Jesus, was in the beginning, and the world was made through him. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. All things were made by him, and without him nothing. God had a plan. That was made has been made. See, God had a plan from the very beginning. He had a plan that he was going to save us. And God himself would bring peace on the earth by taking the place of the sinner and carrying the penalty of man's rebellion upon his own shoulders. And this is why John 3:16 is so powerful, is that God didn't have to do this. But because of his great love, he chose to do this. He chose to save us. Why? Because you sitting here today, God wanted you to be at one with him. Atonement. He wanted you to be brought back to closeness with him. Because sin, we're all sinners. We need to have a sacrifice for our sins. We need Jesus to wash our sins away. And because of that, Jesus was born in the flesh. Now, Jesus was the son of David. And he was David's line. And there was a prophecy given to David in 1 Chronicles 17:11-14. When your days are over and you go to be with your ancestors, I will raise up your offspring to succeed you, one of your sons. I will establish his kingdom. He is the one who will build a house for me, and I will establish his throne forever. I will be his father, and he will be my son. I will never take my love away from him, as I took it away from your predecessor. I will set him over my house and my kingdom forever. His throne will be established forever. Jesus, the Son of God and Son of Man, was of the house and lineage of David. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of David, his ancestor. He will rule over the people of Jacob forever, and his kingdom will never end. Then Mary said to the angel, "How will this happen, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to Mary, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will cover you. For this reason, the baby will be holy and will be called the Son of God." So that was the prophecy given to Mary. So she was miraculously pregnant with a child conceived by the Holy Spirit, and her fiancé, Joseph, who was also from the house and lineage of David, he was also visited by an angel supernaturally and was told in a dream. The angel of the Lord, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream. In Matthew 1:20 we read, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord said through the prophet, "The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel," which means God with us. So, 9 months later, Mary and Joseph were in the town of Bethlehem, otherwise known as the city of David, to register for a census. Rome had called everybody to go to the hometown of their forefathers to register. So they went to Bethlehem. And we read from the Advent scripture today in Luke chapter 2. Now there were in the same country shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, about them, and they were greatly afraid. Then the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord." So these shepherds were there, and they were told where they would find the Savior child. So they came to the fields, and they found Jesus lying in the manger, just as the angel had told them. But this wasn't all. We see in Matthew 2:1-6, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is this one who's been born King of the Jews? We saw a star when it rose and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Messiah was to be born. "In Bethlehem in Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written, 'But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for out of you will come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel.'" So we're told about these wise men who came from the east, these magi. We don't know if they were kings or not. We have the song, "We Three Kings." But they were wise men that came from the east, presenting Jesus with valuable gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. So this was all This was all predicted. Jesus Christ, the Son, the Savior, and the King would come into the world on that first Christmas night. And that Son grew up and he became a man. The Gospels speak to us about the life of Jesus and his ministry. The Word became flesh, and he made his dwelling amongst us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. So when Jesus walked among us, he taught us and he showed us what God was like with skin on. He taught us about who he was, and indeed he was wonderful, and his counsel was awesome. He offers wonderful counsel to whoever would obey his instructions. So Isaiah's prophetic word that the Son would be called Wonderful Counselor has come to pass. But it extends beyond good moral instruction, good counsel. He'd be called Mighty God, Everlasting Father. Jesus, in his life, told the people that he and the Father were one. And the Son is the exact representation of the Father's glory. If you've seen me, Jesus said, you've seen the Father. John the Baptist testified of Jesus when he saw Jesus coming down to the river at the start of his ministry. When we see that, Jesus came down, and the next day John saw Jesus coming toward him. In John 1, 29 to 30, we read, "Look, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. He is the one that I meant when I said, a man who comes before me has surpassed me because he was before me." And Jesus, when he went into the waters of baptism, the heavens opened, and the voice of the Father came from heaven saying, "This is my Son in whom I am well pleased." And the Holy Spirit in bodily form like a dove alighted on him, came down upon him. So we see the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit at the start of Jesus' ministry. This is an endorsement that God the Son of Man, was coming to pay the price for this, for the sins of the world. As humanity, we owed a debt we couldn't pay. But God had plans to give his life in exchange for our life. In Isaiah 44:6, it's written, this is what the Lord said, "Israel's King and Redeemer, the Lord Almighty, I am the first, I am the last. Apart from me, there is no God." Jesus is God. He is our Redeemer. He is our King. He is a representation of everything that God is. He is God in the Son. And the writer of Hebrews tells us, the Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. After he had provided purifications for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty in heaven. In John 1, he says, 1 verses 11 to 13, he came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, children not born of natural descent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. The Jews didn't believe it. The Jews wouldn't accept it. But Jesus came, and he said to them that he was the great I am. And then he proceeded to give his life. He gave his life on the cross for you and for me. And he saved us from our sins. So whoever believes in Jesus, the wrath of God no longer comes down upon us, but the wrath of God is visited upon Christ. The wrath of God was poured out in full measure on Christ, satisfying the justice that needed to be done, so that when we come to him, we can come to him and hide beneath the shadow of his wings, so his covering covers over us, and his blood washes our sin and takes our sins and casts it as far as the east is from the west, never to be remembered again. And that's good news this morning. That's the Christmas message this morning, that the Savior came. He was crushed. He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. And by his stripes, by his wounds, we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid upon him the iniquity of us all. And finally, in John 1, Jesus said, he came to which is his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to them who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, children not born of natural descent, nor human's decision or husband's will, but born of God. John said this of Jesus. And it's written by Paul in Romans 10. There is no difference between Jew and Gentile. The same Lord is Lord of all, and richly blesses all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. So, this morning, I trust that you would reflect on all these things, and that you'd be thankful for Jesus, for what he's done. God came to us. He gave himself to us because of his love. He paid the full price for our sins, and if we place our trust in him, are given eternal life. Amen.